incredibly famous individual, senator, minister, ad man, a true Renaissance man, an incredibly, incredibly good author. And I, by the way, do not praise people lightly. I'm Nadya Chishty Mujahid, an academic. And it's my honor and pleasure and privilege to moderate this session. I've introduced Javed Jabbar Sahab, and I'm going to let him do much of the speaking, occasionally tossing in a provocative question to just throw him off track, which I love doing. But he will speak at length about elements of this unique book called What is Pakistaniat? I highly recommend that you buy it and read it. I have 100+ publications to my credit and have reviewed 80 books in various venues. Good quality books, and this one really grabs me. Okay, so I don't give praise lightly. Let me go ahead and read an interesting passage for you from the preface. So I'm going to read that. With the valued interest of the Chief of Army Staff, General Qamar Javed Bajwa, in the subject of fostering an increased awareness on the formative dimensions of national identity, three different versions of this text, with adaptations as required for the respective levels of average ages, were prepared in mid-2018 for use at the matric, intermediate, and graduate/postgraduate senior levels for all the education and training institutions of the Pakistan Army. The then Inspector General Training and Evaluation, GHQ, Lieutenant General, retired Hidayat ur Rahman, the then Director General, Human Resource Department, GHQ Major General Zafar ul Haq, and Brigadier Munir Yasin, and other senior officers and faculty, both military and civil, contributed constructive, thoughtful comments. This should give you an indication of how important the book is on some fronts. But I leave it to Javed Jabbar Sahab now to give you a synopsis of this and to elucidate what he wishes his book to achieve. So.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you, Nadia, for your very kind and generous introduction. It's a privilege for me to be with a literature critic who is unforgiving, but who is very appropriate in the way she formulates her incisive reviews of books on a very periodic, regular basis for Dawn Books and Authors. And of course, parentage counts. Me being a thorough feudal, I mean, you know, her father and her mother, that's the whole point. I mean, whose daughter is she? That's the whole point, nay? There's no such thing as individual merit. It's all in your genes. All in your genes from...
Your genes are pretty good.
yes, my modest and humble. But the reason I refer to that specially before I come back, I want to thank all of you, misguided souls that you are, sacrificing other sessions, sacrificing your time this beautiful morning, fantastic, and actually willing to suffer for a few minutes, quite a few minutes with us. Thank you. And thanks to Amina Sayyid and Asif for initiating this, mashallah. This proximity to power is so intoxicating, you know? Governor House, but the refreshing thing is the lack of protocol here. A beautiful change in the whole milieu, you know, the ethos of how you enter a public building. So it's very good to be here. Thank you, Nadia, for that introduction. She's very mischievously chosen to read a section from my preface. I know all these subtle plans she's up to. She picks a paragraph which refers to this innocent, peace-loving chief of army staff. I mean, you know, an institution that only believes in gentle persuasion. They never use force or weapons. They speak with very gentle voice and they have only the best interests of the country at heart. But she chose to speak, and I think it's an honor. It's an honor for suddenly out of the blue for the head of a very important institution to send you a message that he wants to communicate on this basis. I've dealt with previous chiefs of army staff. I have the dubious or singular distinction of having resigned from the cabinet of a serving chief of army staff, General Pervez Musharraf. So while I fully respect chiefs of army staff, I'm not intimidated or overawed by them. They're also human beings. But what touched me was the fact that this gentleman had taken the trouble to read a book called Pakistan Unique Origins, A Unique Destiny, which I had written earlier, released in 2011, where amongst the 60 strengths and 40 weaknesses of Pakistan, I had suggested that the 60th strength after 59 strengths, the 60th strength is the evolution of what one called Pakistaniat in a brief period of that time, 65 years. And he saw that, and I had not elaborated it too much. In successive editions, I had expanded that concept. And there was a lot of interest wherever the book was launched or whatever in this concept. So, ironically, I had felt that, you know, one must expand it into a book form. And as I was doing it, I get this call. But this book was not written for the army. This book was written by myself as an individual writer. And my condition for writing those three adapted versions was that the text must be accepted according to how I interpret it. I will pay due deference to what they think cannot be in the text. And to their credit, they did not draw a red line and said, no, sorry, this cannot be part of the text. Perhaps I appropriately had formulated the text in a way that had to be acceptable. I mean, if this book is to be read by jawans who are only metric pass and who are entering the institution, and the only merit-based institution in the country, one could say apart from the civil service, one does not want them to be unduly loaded with all the misgivings or reservations we have about the role of the military. We don't want to subvert their sense of self-confidence in what they are doing. But at the same time, it was necessary to caution them that the civil-military relationship in Pakistan is subject to a lot of unease. So, to their credit, the chief of army staff agreed that there must be an element in the section called troubled identity where the writer feels that this relationship has had an impact on our sense of identity and should be resolved, reconciled. So that's the background. It's a book, this one is virtually the same as is being taught at the National Defense University or the Command and Staff College, except for maybe a couple of sentences that had to be adjusted purely for public use. And it grew out of the fact that as a Pakistani by choice, a Pakistani whose father decided that he wanted to become a Pakistani. And in my own personal life, there has been this early rupture between my father and my mother. So I went back to India with my mother when I was very young. And then I'm secretly or openly very proud that as a child, I reasserted my desire to come back to Pakistan. I don't know what drove me here, but I loved the concept, the notion of Pakistan. And I fell in love with this country a second time when I stepped onto the soil in January 1958. And since then, the love affair is just growing. Of course, the love affair is not all milk and honey. And there are plenty of aspects of it which disturb me a great deal. And some years ago, I felt, what is our national identity? And I'm going to just stop Nadya in a couple of minutes by saying, especially when children in schools I would speak at, or universities, or even citizens would say, kya Javed sahab, kaha hai nation hai? Hum toh abhi tak apne aap ko Punjabi kehte hain, Muhajir kehte hain, Sindhi kehte hain. We have not become a nation. Look at India. India is a nation. And I had to disabuse them of this false notion that India is a nation. There are 7 states in Northeast India called the Assamese sister states of Mizoram and Meghalaya, where they do not accept being Indian. So building a national identity is a historical process of evolution. And there's no contradiction between being a Sindhi and a Punjabi and being a Pakistani. Being a Sunni and Pakistani, being a Shia and Muslim, being a Muslim and Pakistani, being a Christian and Pakistani. So, I just felt that we have something in our pockets called the NIC, National Identity Card. And it struck me that maybe we should drop the A and L after the word national. And you drop A and L and put an apostrophe and say S. Nation's identity card. What is our nation's identity card? And that's when I come to DNA, your parents' DNA, which is in you, but you are such an individual in your own right. What is Pakistan's DNA? That's what I tried to find through this book. And at some point, and that's my last point, can you quantify identity? Can you say 10% of this identity is this and 20% is this? Yes and no. I think arithmetic and mathematics has something to do with constituting a composite. So I attempted to enumerate them. And at the risk of being very immodest, one has, I think, presented for the first time 30 positive elements and 11 negative elements, which all help to make us the crazy nation we are. Crazy and yet lovable. So I'll stop there and I'll only try to invite your attention to the titles of those 41, if I have your permission.
Yes, yes, please
then,
go ahead.
And then you can, add or subtract. I've divided these 41 into 5 clusters. The first cluster is individual identity. An individual identity consists of 6 elements. 1, proud to be Muslim in a predominantly Muslim nation. Even if a Muslim is a single Muslim in Iceland, he's proud to be Muslim. But to be Muslim in a country where 97% are Muslim gives you a tremendous sense of self-assurance. It's different. So that's one, number one. Number two, pride in being part of a larger community of Muslims spread across this Asian region, in South Asia, Bangladesh, Afghanistan, elsewhere. We are not just alone. We are not just Muslims living in a small pocket in a German town. We are here in South Asia. Number three, proud of living in a land where one of humanity's first civilizations began. You know, 10,000 years ago, humanity decided to stop wandering around killing animals and living off trees and started becoming agriculturists, 10,000 years ago, and domesticating animals. Within 1,000 years, Mehrgarh in Balochistan was established. One of the very first pioneering human civilizations on the planet, Pakistan's land. So we are proud to be part of that, long before Mohenjo-daro, Number four, proud to be part of tribes and clans residing on lands which later in 1947 became part of Pakistan. People who've been, whose ancestors have lived here for hundreds of years, Baloch tribes, Pakhtun tribes, Punjabi Jats, Palijos, what have you in Sindh. Number five, pride in becoming a Pakistani by choice through migration. I've already elaborated that. Number six, pride in being Hindu, Christian, Zoroastrian, Sikh, Buddhist Pakistanis. I know that there's a negativity to that, but these people are, as I've said it in this book, the original Pakistanis. They are the first Pakistanis because this land belongs to them. This is their land. Just as the land of North America and South America belonged to the original Native Americans, which was taken over by the Europeans. But here, in our case, thank God, those like us who migrated have not taken over Punjab or Sindh. We are a minority. But these people whose faiths predate Islam are the original Pakistani. So these are six elements of individual identity. The second cluster is collective identity. Because, you know, in the first six, you can't be both Muslim and Christian Pakistani. And they are not comprehensive. You have to choose what you are. But in cluster B, we have a collectivity. All can be part of it and are part of it. Number one, born resilient. Aha, kya baat. Look at the way we were born. No country in the world, no country in recorded history was created with two wings separated by 1,000 miles of hostile territory. Alaska is far away from mainland America. Hawaii is far away. But the population of Hawaii and Alaska, fractional. Here, 52% sitting in one part, 48% sitting 1,000 miles away. Fantastic. When I say to my American friends, American university audiences understand it very easily. I said, you characters, you rascals in America, you better understand how we became a nation. There, where those characters are hopefully putting up my books for sale, which you must buy at the end of this session. Imagine them to be New York. And imagine these characters there to be California. And right, guess who's here? Russia. Nadia and I are Russia. Would America have developed with Russia in the middle? But Pakistan did. We developed with India in the middle, which said, Pakistan won't last 6 months. And they tried their best to prove it. Number eight, the second element of collective identity, enduring resilience. Wow, wow, wow. Kya baat. Enduring. Not just born freakish. In the first 15, 20 years, enduring resilience. We go to war. We go to war on Kashmir within weeks. We don't have money to pay salaries. The Nizam of Hyderabad, Deccan, secretly sends money, which is never acknowledged to this date publicly. And we manage. We manage to draw up five-year plans with the South Koreans come to pick up and implement. The Malaysians look up to Pakistan in the 1960s. Why? What kind of a incredible country this was. Enduring resilience. Third, pride in Pakistan's resurgence after the body blow of 1971. What a blow it was. Not just a physical blow, it was an emotional blow, a psychological blow. Most countries would have collapsed. They would have said, kya hua aapki two-nation theory? Aray baba, two-nation theory survives. It survived 71. Why did it survive? because the East Pakistanis rejected only the state of Pakistan. They didn't reject the nation, the national concept of Muslim nationalism. Bangladesh today does not want to merge itself with West Bengal because they have the same language or the same ethnicity. They are proud to be Muslim. So the two-nation theory survives 2019. So Pakistan survived 71 and renewed itself. Number 10, pride in belonging to a beautiful country. Look at the land of Pakistan. My God. From the Karakorams to the coastline. Every inch of this country, so gorgeous, so blessed. Fruit, orchards, vegetables, minerals. 11, pride in a country whose location has global strategic significance. I'm not disrespecting my favorite Paraguay in South America. Paraguay is a fine country. But Paraguay, I'm sorry to say, has no global or regional strategic significance. Pakistan has both regional and global strategic significance. Number 12, collective identity ka barwa number, guess what? We have a very democratic temperament. Kya baat hai ji? Bade jamhuri log hain. Char fauji madakhlat ke bawajood, boy, all year, bar associations, teachers bodies, labor unions, medical associations, architects, engineers, all holding elections. Private clubs, Karachi Gymkhana, Sindh Club, everywhere, everyone is a candidate. Aisi politics wahan hoti hai, main jo shayad assembly ke elections mein na ho. Thoroughly democratic. We love electing people, love becoming candidates. Number 13, a youthful, zestful persona. Wo to hai ye, 60% of us are under the age of 30. Lekin mashallah, meri bhi umar 25 hai. Lekin I feel I'm 16, 17. So, youthful, zestful persona. Number 14, a passion for play. Khel kood mein bada shauk, padhai mein nahi itna shauk. Cricket dekhne ke liye tamasha, har cheez qurban. Even old grandmothers watch cricket. Young grandmothers, sorry. Number 15, global Pakistanis. Aha, overseas. Living in Toledo, Ohio. Living in California. Wherever, Pakistan ke saath, that connection never weakens. Even if they have dual nationality. Number 16. Overwhelming majority. Miana Rawai. Moderate. Balanced. Pluralistic. Intiha pasand nahi. Large majority. Aur main sare mulk mein kaam karta hoon. Aur ye main waise koi boastful andaaz mein nahi arz kar raha. Bade hum humility ke saath keh raha hoon. 35 se 40 saal ho gaye. I work across all four provinces. I work in villages, I work in towns, in Balochistan se leke upar. And, nahi, main kya keh raha hoon? Ke I don't come across this jaraseem of intiha pasandi in these towns. It's a small segment, that virus that has allowed to magnify itself. So we are a very moderate country. Number 17, dehshat gardi ke khilaaf ek jo ubhra hai, upsurge, you know, this nafrat is something that we share. We don't want these jahils to succeed. On that, virtually, we are united. Number 18, an exceptionally compassionate, generous people. Kya bada dil hai hamara. Kai dafa, mujhe sharam aati hai, mere agar galti se mera bichara driver chala raha ho gaadi aur main seth saab ki tarah piche baitha hoon. Yeah, traffic light pe mera driver apni jeb se dega. Halanki I know that character is a part of a beggar's mafia. Lekin a poor man in Pakistan gives even more frequently than the rich. The rich give more. What a country. And by international surveys have shown Pakistanis are amongst the most generous in the world. Fantastic. Number 19, an infinite capacity for hospitality. Wah, wah, wah. Kya mehman nawazi hamari hai. Jaan na pehchan, unko bulane ke liye tayyar. Ghair ko bhi bula lenge. Aray, humare ghar aayye, baithiye. Wah, wah, wah. Abhi kuch shikwa hai. Vaisse mere do teen chehre yahan nazar aa rahe hain jinhone ab tak mujhe ghar pe nahi bulaya hai. Lekin generally we are so hospitable. Number 20, a spontaneously helpful and warm and friendly persona. Sadak pe gaadi kharab ho jaye, koi kisi ki musibat ho, are paanch log pahunchenge aapko foran madad karne ke liye. Instinctive qism ka reflexive action. So that's collective identity. Cluster C. Evolving. Abhi bhi humari shinaakh ban rahi hai. Kuch pehlu. Aur uske hain paanch. Number 8. The use of Urdu as a national lingua franca. Even though the latest census shows that Urdu is the mother tongue of less than 9% of the people of Pakistan. 9%. East Pakistan mein Bengali is the mother tongue of 98%, 95% of the people. But what a miracle it is ki Urdu aap bologe to Gilgit mein bhi samajh lenge, Gawadar mein bhi samajh lenge, Chicha Watni mein bhi samjhi jayegi. Lekin saath saath, bade fakhr ke saath, ہم 24 سے زیادہ اپنی علاقائی زبانیں اور بولیاں بولتے ہیں چاہے گجراتی ہو کاتیاواڑی ہو ڈھاٹکی ہو بلتی ہو سو یوز آف اردو ایوالونگ ایز اٹ گوز نمبر 2 آف دا ایوالونگ آئیڈینٹی وی آر کمفرٹیبلی کاسموپولیٹن اینڈ یٹ تھرلی پاکستانی رات کو بڑی اچھی میوزک ویسٹرن میوزک پہ ڈانس کریں گے اور کچھ کوکا کولا پیئیں گے اور ساتھ ساتھ جا کر کل صبح اٹھ کے نماز پڑھیں گے اینڈ وی ڈونٹ فیل اینی کانٹرڈکشن خاص طور پہ کوکا کولا پینے کے بعد وی ٹیک بوتھ تھنگز ان آر اسٹرائڈ وی آر سو ایبل ٹو بی پارٹ آف اے ماڈرنسٹ آؤٹ لک اینڈ یٹ آلسو ریممبر آر بینگ ایسٹرن and being Muslim. So it's unusual combination. Number 23, my favorite. Aye, aye, aye. Pakistani women. Marvels of dignity, capability, and beauty. Oi, 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 kya baat hai.
I notice your wife.
Arey, main khush Mrs. خوش قسمت ہوں کہ اس سے میری شادی میں اس کے بارے میں ایک اور سلسلے میں ذکر کرنے والا ہوں ناگزیر ہے نہیں نہیں بٹ ہماری خواتین اینڈ دس از ناٹ جسٹ سیٹ ٹو پلیز ویمن آئی ڈونٹ نیڈ ٹو سے ٹو پلیز دیم دے ڈونٹ نیڈ می ٹو سے اٹ بٹ ٹرولی دوسرے بھی ممالک کی عورتوں کو ہم ملتے ہیں بڑے مہذب انداز میں اور سوال ہی نہیں آر ویمن آر ہیڈ اینڈ شولڈرز ابو دی ادر اینڈ دس از نو ڈس ریسپیکٹ ٹو اے سرٹن کنٹری My favorite anecdote, ہماری بیوی صاحبہ کچھ مہینے پہلے گرلز اونلی پارٹی کر رہی تھیں گھر پہ تو موصوف دیر سے آئے گھر واپس جانتے ہوئے کہ بھائی میری تو ضرورت نہیں ہے اٹس اے گرلز پارٹی بٹ دا ساؤنڈ کمنگ فرام دا ڈرائنگ روم ارریزسٹیبل بڑی میٹھی آوازیں آ رہی تھیں خاص طور پہ میری بیوی کی آواز نہیں اچھا تو آئی پاپڈ ان ٹو دا ڈرائنگ روم جسٹ ٹو سے ہیلو What a gallery of beauties. Oi, oi, oi. Maine kaha, dekha, ye ijtema sabit karta hai ke Pakistani women are the most beautiful, not only in South Asia, but across the world. So, kuch to applause aayi, lekin stunned silence. Because there happened to be a visiting Indian woman sitting in that group. And to add salt to the wound, I said, have you ever been to India and seen them? Talk about putting my foot in my mouth. I'm so good at it. I put both feet in my mouth. But truly, I mean, look at the way they work. دیہات میں جاؤ کیا کام کرتی ہیں ایک کتاب چھپی تھی called Invisible Farmers about 30 years ago and this writer had documented کہ ایک دن میں ایک خاتون دیہات میں کتنے مختلف specialized کام کرتی ہے مال مویشی کا خیال گھر کا پکوان بچوں کا خیال بدماش کا خیال ہر چیز کھیتی باڑی fantastic number 24 ingenuous and innovative تخلیقی شوق ہر سنڈے کو ڈان میں آپ دیکھئے گا گزشتہ کئی مہینوں سے سنڈیز کو بزنس پیج کے بیس پہ مطاہر خان is publishing a series called Tech Talk and he's identifying young Pakistanis who are doing incredible things in information technology, software applications, meeting niche needs which have not previously been met. And many of our applications have been applauded overseas as well. And I don't want to go into detail, it's self-explanatory, how innovative and adaptive we are when aid is cut off, when sanctions are applied, we find ways to survive. 25, that's where I was going to refer, moving towards a new Pakistani ethnic identity. We are not an ethnic nation, unlike the Chinese, 80% Han Chinese. We are not like the Turks. We are not like the Iranians. We are not like the Egyptians. We are literally an overnight nation. And we are evolving. Pakhtuns are marrying Baloch. I know many nationalist leaders of Balochistan who have married into Pakhtun families living happily in Quetta and in Turbat. And I set the example. I came here and discovered a lovely woman from Kashmir and Punjab. Madrasi, Hyderabad, Dakani, married a fair-looking Kashmiran, Punjaban, beautiful. Our children, Mehreen and Kamal, my God, look at the confluence of southern DNA, northern DNA. And in the next two, three generations, four generations, five generations from now, their children, children, children will be Pakistani children. But this ethnic identity, we shouldn't be worried that it will take time. And there's something special about it. Even before we become ethnically Pakistani, I'm walking down Oxford Street. Oh, 100 nationalities. Do mujhe mard nazar aa jayen, approximately from South Asia. Teen aa jayen. I can tell ke that badmash is a Pakistani. Because ek Pakistani shakhsiyat mein ek khas rujhan humne develop kar liya hai. Kya wo gosht khane ki wajah se hai? چاہے خر دماغی کی وجہ سے ہے چاہے مسلمان وہ ہونے کی وجہ سے ہے کچھ ہے پاگلپن ہے کریزینس ہے پاکستانی پرسونا has developed even before we become an ethnic Pakistani nation the next cluster second last I know you've been very patient assertive identity The first, pride in being a citizen of a nuclear weapon state. Only Muslim country to have nuclear weapons, able to deter. Dekha, taali bhi baj gayi is pe. Sabse non-Islamic weapon, which can destroy people indiscriminately, the innocent as well as the combatants, and yet we had no choice. And India forced us. Number 27, افواج پاکستان میں بڑا فخر باوجود اس کے کہ انہوں نے چار دفعہ مداخلت کی باوجود اس کے کہ بہت تاریخی غلطیاں کی جس کی وجہ سے بہت نقصان ہوا پاکستان لیکن جس بہادری سے جوان تیار ہے اپنی جان دینے کے لیے جس بہادری کے ساتھ افسران بھی and let me say that very few armies in the world have a record like Pakistan's armed forces where officers have also lost their lives. Normally, it's the jawans, the soldiers. Here, people up to the rank of colonel, brigadier, even major generals have been assassinated by terrorists. Number 28, celebrating national days with fervor. Kitne josh ke saath bachcha bhi gaata hai qaumi tarana. Jis josh ke saath hum qaumi jhande ko dekhkar aansu aate hain kabhi kabhi aankhon mein. There is a fervor. Chahe wo Independence Day ho, 23rd March ho, Qaid-e-Azam's birthday ho, there's that. And then pride in being part of that exclusive, jiska maine persona zikr kiya, called Pakistani. Number 30, and the last of the positive elements, alas, sirf 30 hain. Regardless of prevailing and persistent problems, blind faith in a stable future Pakistan. Kuch bhi ho jaye ji, aise hum dheet khom hain, bardasht kar lenge. We'll survive. Ab aati hai talkh haqeeqat, which some people will love, of course. Not too many, I hope. 11 elements of troubled identity. 31. Deep concern at the country's numerous crises. Every Pakistani knows kitne shadeed hamare masail hain is waqt. Chahe governance ke hon, kirdar ke hon, badintizami ke hon, corruption ke hon, blah, blah, blah. Deep concern. Everyone shares it. Number 32. An obsessive interest in politics and democracy. Sara waqt ye talk show dekh dekh kar, kaan ke se bahar nikal rahi hai siyasat. Everyone is a political dynamo, but accompanied by indifference. 50% turnout at elections. Hardly anyone wants to become a member of a political party. Everyone wants to talk about politics and democracy, but very few want to do anything to strengthen it. 3, citizens' deep distress at the terrible standards of public sector education. Knowing that we have split ourselves into 3 Pakistanis, madrasa Pakistanis, matric level Pakistanis, and O-level, A-level Pakistanis. None of them communicate with each other. The madrasa guy doesn't know about maybe John Keats, and the A-level, O-level guy hasn't even heard of Mir Taqi Mir, leave alone Haleeb. 35, an unease about the political-military relationship. Maine jiska shuru hi mein zikr kar diya tha. We know that while the army and the armed forces are a very genuine merit-based institution, no one's bhatija becomes chief of army staff because his uncle was chief of army staff. Nevertheless, army ke jo privileges hain, army ka jo ek influence hai, security policy par, internal affairs par, and aspects of missing persons par, the role of the intelligence agencies. Deep unease. Number 36, virtual apathy about a decline in values and ethics. We've just come to accept it. Jad jad mein ye pahunch gayi hai baat, deemak ki tarah. Aur usme maine shamil kiya hai the crude behavior by some in public places, jo ehtiram, adab hona chahiye. Number 37, oppression of the weak. Jahan bhi jiske paas lathi ho, danda ho, aur khas taur par khawateen aur bachchon ke haqooq ko jo hum violate karte hain throughout the country, even in big cities like Karachi, there is daily violation of women's rights and children's rights, in which even educated people connive, despite being educated. Number 38, connivance in and acceptance of corruption at a massive level, at a micro level. Number 39, mazhab ke baare mein, oi, 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 baat hi nahi ho sakti. Emotional volatility about religion. You cannot have a balanced discourse in a public place, especially about religion. Whether it is university campuses or whether it is any forum like this, we'll get away here, I hope, but you are immediately subject to accuse and suspicion of blasphemy. Number 40, prone, aha, ye bahut shauk hai. Prone to accept conspiracy theories. Wow, America, Israel, or India, hain to wo tino badmash, lekin domestically, conspiracy, army, aur kaun sa, ISI, of course, ISI to har cheez mein hai, ISI, army, feudals, wagaira, bas, that's it. Sari conspiracy hai ye, aur hum bade masoom hai, I mean, you know, we have nothing to do with this, we are just the victims. Lastly, being unduly negative and always blaming leaders, rarely acknowledging self-responsibility. 41 elements. Sorry for the delay, but I have imposed them on you. Thank you for your patience, Nadya. Those are the 41 elements.
Okay. So now let me provoke Jabbar. So I love it. Let me shift the focus from your macro assessment of the country to you. You've been in filmmaking, an ad man. Woman will always be Laila. Famous line of yours. And then, of course, have held positions of great power and influence, and yet have this deep concern for humanity, which is exhibited in the tons of work that you have done for the country and for the country's poor, etc. And you are at heart creative, and yet you also have tasted of power. And so you truly are a Renaissance man in terms of who you are. What inspired you to become the voice of Pakistaniat? Tell us why this book was destined to be written by you.
My God, thank you for all the preliminary remarks you made, Nadya. I'm very humbled, very whatever little I could do, I've done. There's so much more to be done. You're asking me to conduct self-analysis, like self-criticism, which is the most difficult thing you can do, to be objectively self-critical about yourself. I suppose, in some ways, I was deeply insecure, shaped by my family circumstances of, and I don't want to go on about it. It'll be, I'm not going to, you know, hold my parents responsible for their divorce. When people part, they have to part. There's no bitterness or acrimony, but it does have a residual effect on the child. So I suppose I was riven by a deep sense of insecurity in childhood. And I found it in my mother partly, and then I gave it up and I found it in my father. But most of all, I think I was looking for certainty and security and reassurance that this land that where one has chosen to come and live is going to continue. There's going to be stability. There is meaning and substance and value in this land, in the people. And from that, one draws some energy. And that is how one wanted to plunge into this country and go to places where, whose language I don't speak. Amongst my many limitations is, I can only speak and write in Urdu and English. And I often speak first and think later, which is my common practice. So I speak with people who live in Tharparkar, who speak Dhatki, Now, for 34 years, there's been no communication problem at all. Main Urdu mein bolta hoon, kabhi kabhi angrezi mein, wo mujhe samajh lete hain, main unko samajh leta hoon. Kyunki language is the least important part of communication. It's the eyes, it's your actions, what you do, not what you say. So, I was looking for, I think, security and looking for my own identity, trying to discover what I was. And in that, I thought maybe make the people suffer and say, we are also all looking for an identity. But on a larger scale, this kind of a uniquely created country that we are needs to now come to terms, hopefully, over the next few generations, what it is we are, and to take pride in it. And to keep continuing questioning some of those troubling elements, reform them. In each of those troubled elements, I have suggested a way forward, and my own modest proposals on how we can rectify those 11 flaws in our identity. And I have many flaws in my identity, which I have to address.
While reading this book, I was struck by how gracious your tone is, even in the negative elements. And I think with every book you write, you get better in terms of writing. Speak further to us about your passion for writing, because you have many strong points. I'm not going to dwell on any flaws, and I can't see any flaws in you, Javed Saab. But what I'm saying is...
Ask Shabnam Jabbar.
She was remarkably silent in meet our friend JJ. So, but about that later. So, you're a brilliant speaker, and since you have gone on about my DNA, I will say that I used to think my father's voice was one of the best ever, and it really is one of the best in the country. However, he does admit, and so do I, that yours is better. Beautiful pitch and timber of voice. There are a few great voices in Pakistan. Talat Hussain's, Aslam Azhar's, my dad's, Iftikhar Ahmed's, and yours. And yours is this sort of beautiful, towering presence of a voice. And so... I want to know, though, that though you're an excellent speaker, you seem to have a passion for writing and for language. Would you like to tell us a bit more about that? Because when people buy this book, and I strongly urge them to do so, and read it, they will be struck by how elegant, simple, beautiful, and gracious your tone is throughout.
You're so kind. Thank you so much, Nadya. Well, I have to credit my dear mother for turning me to writing at the age of 9, asking me to sit down and write a poem, open these doors of the magic of writing, the supreme form of communication, the purest form, where the writer and his pen and his mind, and the reader, undistracted by a face or a voice or the circumstance, is just communicating directly, or no better form of communication through text other than the eyes-to-eyes contact. So, writing continues to be a tremendous challenge. I mean, this is my 16th book, but there are 4 more on the anvil, one hopefully at the end of this year on my relationship with Benazir Bhutto. I should have written this earlier, I did, but I haven't yet finalized it, so it should be out hopefully, inshallah, end of this year. And another one on my work in Tharparkar and the rest of the country, and others to come. So, writing is a constant challenge. I mean, it challenges you every day, that blank page, the blank screen on a computer if I write, but there's nothing like writing with the pen and paper. And you discover yourself. It's a very selfish, it's a narcissistic kind of process. You're looking at your navel and you're trying to prevent yourself from thapkoing yourself each time when you write something nice. So it's challenging never to become complacent as a writer and to keep reading and realize how great and rich is the range of writing today in the world, whether it is Gabriel Garcia Marquez's magical realism, which you can reread and be enthralled by every time, or Jose Saramagos from Portugal, another writer who's not so well known here, but what a writer, the one who wrote Blindness. And anyway, so there's so much to learn. So writing, dear, is something I would urge everyone to take up. Everyone is a writer. Everyone has creativity. We just stifle it. And we say, no, writing is not for me. You learn to write when you're in school. I've just taken it beyond writing for exams, and I'm examining it. And I've written 16 books of non-fiction. Mm-hmm. But in a way, all writing conceals the writer. It doesn't reveal the writer. Mm. So now, fiction is the one that challenges me, because that will be the ultimate undressing. And I hate to get undressed in public. So let's see how it goes.
Well, that can be a bit embarrassing, but I think you will accomplish that with grace. But let me comment briefly on this book that was put together by your friends, Meet Our Friend JJ, which was one of the first that I read affiliated with you and was at the book launch. And your elegant wife very wisely refused to contribute to that, which I thought was sweet and humorous. But I was struck by the incredible diversity of the opinions in that book. You have some friends here. I suppose you have a few enemies here and there as well. It would be interesting to read Meet Our Enemy, JJ. But there were opinions from the very, very elite of Pakistan and some incredibly poor people, you know. And I was overwhelmed by the diversity of the number of people whose lives you have touched in various ways. Well, positive ways. It was Meet Our Friend, JJ. And so I want you to comment further on that unique aspect of yourself that enables you to get along with all walks of society. How is that? How do you do that? It's magical.
Yeah. So, again, you're being very generous, Nadia. I think perhaps it comes from, I'm not exceptional. Everyone is exceptional. Everyone is unique. I suppose it comes from respecting every person, regardless of education levels, regardless of income levels, regardless of sophistication. So, I mean, I can connect immediately with Zarina living in Nagar Parkar. She's a widow. And she's been working with us in Bambeli for over 30 years. Zarina, I can connect to Maula Bakhsh in Dera Ghazi Khan. And D.I. Khan, there's another Abdul Haq. So, I mean, one does not want to go into this feeling of immodesty. I'm just saying empathy. If you respect the other person and look at the world from their point of view, not from your own, and listen to them, listening is very important. It comes naturally. Mm-hmm. So there's no great surprise.
Do you have boundless energy? Okay, I get exhausted sometimes by just noting how much you've done. And that too is a compliment, but I'm sure that, and building a huge career and becoming a living legend, which is what you are, and by the way, I tell it like it is, I'm not actually complimenting you, I'm just not lying. Thank you. See? So I think that You know, given that you are this living legend, you know, and a lot of energy and effort has gone into building your career, I'm sure there were challenges along the way, and it was not easy at many points, especially given the positions you've held. Would you like to comment on that?
That's tough. One cardinal rule I decided on very early was never to say the lethal words, "I don't have the time." I hate those words because they set up a mental block and you eventually never have the time. So I always have the time. I look after, mashallah, 7 organizations today. I'm probably busier than when I was minister in 3 cabinets. No problem, no lack of time. I write, I go, I travel, spend time with my family, friends. So much to do. So the secret of energy is to see the infinite possibilities of time, how you use your time. And it's no credit to me. Everyone can do it if you remove those mental and psychological obstacles with which we are born and you transcend them and you will yourself to use every minute of the day to celebrate the beauty of this planet and life. I think anyone can do it, and you're doing it all the time. You're a homemaker, you're a wife, you're a mother, you're a lecturer, you interrogate innocent authors, and you do it so well. I mean, what else? Fine example. Now, can I ask you about what makes you tick?
No, I was just told by this lady that we are out of time, of course. So I escaped.
It's high time, high time. No. So nice of them to have...
May I request a sincere round of applause for Darbar Saab from the audience? And please,
I'm very
move
grateful
towards
to you, Nadya, for your very,
that
very
was a
kind.
Pleasure.
Thank you so much. Thank you all for suffering through this. Thank you. Thank you very much.